And I'm here to kind of talk about a few things. One is about the physical well-being and what is what I can offer as practical tips, and followed by just a lot of tips about nutrition. And for full disclosure, I am not a nutritionist by background, so I'm not going to go over how to read a nutrition label, but I will give you some practical tips which you can take away while you're walking up down the grocery aisle. And then we'll do a Q&A and follow with another poll. And then I like to talk generically about just some of the cardiovascular myths that are out there, and then follow it with just the general cardiovascular risk factors and approach to medications, and maybe what you should be ought to be asking your providers, including primary care doctors. So we'll go to the next slide here, and let's talk about physical well-being and heart health. Why is this important? I think the most important thing to know about physical well-being is, it has led to better longevity as well as better quality of life. So I provide three different examples of how do you improve your physical well-being if you are not doing this already. Often, like myself, we suffer, some people suffer from joint pains and back pains, and it can often be very difficult to jog and do a very intense exercise. So you ask yourself the question, how do I maintain a good physical well-being, which will help my quality of life and longevity, but I'm unable to actually do intense exercise? The answer is you can. So here's some examples. Obviously, walking is a really good kind of form of exercise. The American College of Cardiology recommends usually 20 to 30 minutes, a moderate pace, a slow pace of walking at least 2 to 4 times per week on the average. And what they also define is moderate intense activity is if you can try to increase your heart rate, and that includes examples like swimming. And I love swimming because swimming is a really good form of exercise, because for folks who have really bad back pain or joint pains, it actually not only helps with cardiovascular exercise, but it helps with your orthopedic issues as well. Often an orthopedic heart doctor or orthopedic doctor or a heart doctor would say swimming, it helps your increasing your heart rate, but it also provides muscle strength around your bones, which then strengthens the improvement with your joint pains. I think it's super important to, have some form of stretching, no matter what exercise you choose. Stretching exercises are important for 5 very important reasons. One is it helps with arthritis. The muscles surrounding your bones often can be very tight and pull on the bones, and then leads to worsening arthritis and joint pains. So making sure you stretch the muscles around each of the joints is extremely important for that. The other is it helps with balance. Patients that I see who often have gait instability, one of the most important questions I ask is, can you go from a sitting to standing position, and where does it hurt? Often they say that, I have thigh pains, I have calf pains, my joints hurt, my knees hurt. And through, sort of supervised activities with physical therapy, when they're stretching, you can see that their balance can actually improve and they have less gait instability. Flexibility is also very important, because when you have trouble with pivoting, for example, often the issue is because the muscles surrounding your joints are so tight and they're pulling on your joints. So then you don't become very mobile, and you can actually lead to issues with pivoting. So if you become more flexible by stretching, your balance as well as your flexibility improve, and your overall strength in turn. Stretching and exercise in general not only leads to physical well-being, but in turn, it helps make you feel better. Endorphins, for example, are released during the forms of exercise. So ultimately, it helps with emotional health as well as mental health. So I give 3 examples of different stretching exercises that you can do at home. One is the quad stretch on the bottom left. The other one is in the middle bottom. You can see somebody just doing some passive leg raises. And then the other one is, if you're trying to stretch your upper body, it's just simple over-the-top left to right motions. So these are three examples that I can provide that you can do easily at home, even if you suffer with a lot of joint and back pains. So let's turn our attention to nutrition. So my goal, hopefully today, in the next subsequent sequence of slides, is to illustrate these six important points. Cholesterol, as we all know, specifically the bad cholesterol, and often we check your LDL, which is one component of your cholesterol panel. LDL is considered the bad cholesterol. And often the six important points is these following. What I want you to emphasize and take home is choosing healthy fats. Not all fats are bad, but it's a matter of choosing the healthy fats. The other is choosing lean protein foods. Examples are salmon. Examples are baked chicken without the skin, and followed with choosing soluble fiber, because fiber, you'll see, is really important, not only for your colon and also your regular bowel movements, but it's actually been shown to help reduce cholesterol. And you'll understand why in the subsequent slides. It's also given to say that avoiding high cholesterol foods, ones that are with high saturated fats, is a very important thing. So choosing healthy fats as a substitution over high cholesterol fats is very, very important. We're always tempted by the high sugar drinks and foods, because who doesn't like sweets? But I think, you know, the ones that you need to understand are the ones with high in sugar, and there often is it's in a balance that you need to take, because sugar drives craving, then leads to more increased calories, including high cholesterol foods. Trans fats is equivalent to what we talk about, high cholesterol foods. You got to love those cupcakes that you get, high in saturated oils, especially on Valentine's Day, which just was around the corner. But those are the ones that you have to avoid, because they often lead to increased calories, but also increased cardiovascular disease. So these are the six take-home points. Let's go through this one by one. Next slide, please. So if you look at fats in general, what I have illustrated is two things. These are some examples on the left-hand side, and then the takeaway points on the right-hand side. Let's start with the takeaway points. So first off, fat has calories. Fat usually has the highest number of calories compared to carbohydrates. But remember, as I said, fat is really still good for you. You need fat to survive, but it's about the best choices of fat that you need to choose. The other thing to also realize is fat is really important for helping absorb some of the nutrients that you often need, the vitamins, for example. But it also is really important to look at what is healthy fats and what's unhealthy fats. So let me give you some examples. Let's focus on the top left. Avocados is a great source of healthy fats. Avocados, though, have a lot of calories. Fish like salmon, particularly baked salmon, is extremely, extremely healthy, important for healthy fats. It has a lot of omega-3 fatty acids. And I have personally at home a lot of recipes for really good baked salmons. And I range from curry salmon to Chinese flavored salmon to Korean based salmon. And I also even do Southern type kind of salmon. I really modify my monotony for, you know, my week with just different flavors of different salmons, baked and broiled. Peanut butter is great, and it has a lot of source of fat, but it also is compounded with a lot of calories. So it is a really good source of healthy fats, but it has a lot of calories. So you have to be careful. If you're on a diet where you're trying to lose a lot of calories, I would be careful with the quantity of the peanut butter that you take. So these are some examples of what I call healthy fats. Let's take a look at the unhealthy fats. Whole milk, for example, has a lot of unhealthy fats. And if you look at the nutrition label, you'll see a lot of saturated fat. Cheese, for example, has a lot of saturated fat. And then looking at any of the milk-based products or even cream-based products has a lot of unhealthy fat. coconut oils, palm oils also have a lot of solid fats. These are the ones that you want to stay away from. Fast foods that provide hamburgers, bacon, sausage, fried foods, they all have unhealthy fats. That's why it tastes so good, but realize they have a lot of unhealthy fats. So at the bottom, you can see some examples of just meal plans that you can choose for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. So often you can start with a whole grain toast with avocado. You can follow it with Greek low-fat yogurt with a little bit of berries. And I always drink skim milk and with no added sugar. You can follow that with lunch. You can mix it up with sandwiches that have avocado instead of cheese. And then you can have chicken or salmon with a skinless chicken that can be a really good source of protein as well as healthy fats. Dinner can often be the same as a lunch, but you can mix it up even with lean ground meats as well. In between meals, it's important to curb your appetite with nuts and seeds. And we'll talk about that on the next slide. A really good snack I often do is hummus. Hummus with whole wheat crackers is often what I do in between. And I often substitute that with Greek yogurt as well. Every day, I alternate that with fresh fruit. And I often alternate that with vegetables with hummus on top of it. So these are some examples of healthy and unhealthy fats in the foods and some real meal regimens. So if we go to the next slide here, I want to provide you with this information of what kind of nuts, because there is a myth out there. The myth is nuts are bad for you. Well, that's not true. It's just a matter of what type of nuts. Unsalted nuts and seeds are really important for just curbing your appetite and a really good source of snacks for you. So here are some examples. So often I like almonds and walnuts. Those are my two go-tos. But some other things you can do is you can actually add flaxseed to the oatmeal. You can actually add it to low-fat yogurts to spice it up. You can even add fruit to it as well. Pine nuts are really good on pasta sauces. That's one of my favorites. And then the last example that I often use is whole grain dry cereal with dried fruit, and I put trail mix in it, and I put skim milk in it. And so these are kind of my go-to examples, but you can often use almonds, pine nuts, pistachios, and any of these meal plans to oatmeals. You can put it to with berries and bananas to your dry cereal and dry fruit. So, you know, these are just different examples. But the most important thing to understand is that 3 or 4 servings of unsalted nuts per week actually has been shown to reduce cardiovascular disease and help with blood pressure and also inflammation. So that is really, really important information to take home. And so, and realize that nuts are not all that bad. So let's go to the next slide. So following nuts, I think a lot of people have this concept that, well, gee, I can't, does that mean I cannot eat any unhealthy food at all? Or, you know, or can I not eat out at all? It makes it seem like that. The answer is no. I choose Southern style foods because the misnomer is that all Southern style foods are bad for you. Well, the answer is no, it's not all unhealthy foods. It's all about your choices. It's all about the right choices. So often if you go out and you're having a good time, you're celebrating a birthday or a wedding, or you're celebrating an anniversary and you're at the meal table and you're trying to figure out, what do I want to do? What do I want to eat? Well, here's some takeaway points. When you're choosing, you can often ask the waiter or the chef, you can say, please substitute more vegetables or fruits for any of the meals. Instead of the rice or the pasta, you can say, well, can I add a little bit more vegetables instead of the white rice? Because the pasta often is cooked in very deep-seeded oil, and it also has a lot of carbohydrates. And if you don't exercise after that, the carbohydrates can often build up and lead to fats. So I often ask for fruits and vegetables on the side rather than rice. Whole grains is the way to go. You can ask specifically if they have whole wheat pasta instead of the mac and cheese. And then the other thing to understand is better protein. So it's the choice of protein. Instead of pork and beef barbecue, you can say, maybe I can have baked chicken breast, or I can have baked salmon. And if the waiter and also the chef is willing to, you can actually say, please do not add salt, add some more flavor. Often in the aisles, you can choose sodium instead of sodium chloride. There are some over-the-counter seasoning substitutes that I often recommend, and that's like potassium chloride. But you have to be careful if you're a patient that is under the care of a heart doctor. You have to ask your heart doctor if it's okay to do that, because sometimes the potassium substitute can make your potassium really high in your blood, and that can often be dangerous. So you just double check with your provider. And then the last thing is reducing the added sugars. Often when you go out and you're having a good time, you want to make sure that instead of a baked potato, you actually ask for baked sweet potato topped with chopped pineapple, for example, with no added sugar applesauce. You know, when you go out and get white turkey breast meat, sometimes they'll, cover the turkey breast with a lot of sweeteners and cranberry and some added sugars sometimes, and that makes it very good. But you want to say, please, can you do away with the added sugars? So, and then on the left-hand side, you'll see some just routine, generic, often common foods that are offered for you: pork and beef, meat, chili, baked potatoes, white rice, mac and cheese, fast foods. And you look on the right-hand side, you can see some of the common examples: baked chicken breasts, white turkey breasts, brown or wild rice rather than white rice, and whole wheat pastas as well. And when I go for breakfast, often I only ask for egg whites and low-fat cheese instead of the yellow in the egg as well. So these are some examples about making the right choices. And not all Southern-style foods are our restaurant foods are all unhealthy, and that's the takeaway. So let's go ahead on the next slide here. And I want to illustrate the concept of fiber. Fiber is good for you. Soluble fiber is good for you. So how does it work? Because you'll look at products like Metamucil, for example. They say it may reduce cholesterol. You may look at Honey Nut Cheerios, and it says it may reduce cholesterol. Well, why is that? Well, the reason is because they often have wheat or soluble fiber in it. And the soluble fiber acts by not absorbing in the bowel. So it takes all the fat, the high saturated fats, it binds to the soluble fiber, and it removes it from your body. That's the mechanism of how it works. Often we recommend about 5 to 10 grams of fiber a day. So that usually is about a cupful of a spoonful to two, maybe three, in a glass of water, and you mix it, and you can put some ice in it, and it actually makes a really yummy drink. And so here are some examples of when I use soluble fiber. Often I do it in between breakfast and lunch, but you can do it any time in the day. So breakfast, my favorite breakfast food is oatmeal, and I love that with a little brown sugar and little berries. That's often my go-to. But before lunch, I often drink a glass of Metamucil because it curbs your appetite. It also helps with cholesterol, and it also helps curb your appetite. So you look at lunch time, and you may want to eat a little bit less. So it helps curb your calories. And then you may actually, have lunch with a little bit of cup of chili with beans, which usually has a good source of fiber. But often pears have a really good source of fiber, and they're really sweet, and it kind of balances that salty taste that you may have with the chili. And so I often go towards pears, and I mix the pears actually in yogurts, and that's my go-to snack. Dinner time, a couple high fiber foods that I can recommend if you're not a fan of any of the suggestions I made is broccoli, carrots, green beans. And steaming it is often really good, because if you fry them, you lose the source of the fiber, the soluble fiber ingredient, and it actually disintegrates. So the steamed version is often really good because it will preserve the ingredients as well as the vitamins and as well as the fiber. So you make, so that's an important point. And specifically, how does soluble fiber help you in terms of your cholesterol? Well, it binds to the LDL, which is your bad cholesterol. And that's why often it's really good. One important point I will say, if you're going to have increased fiber in your diet, make sure you drink extra water. Otherwise, you're going to get very constipated. So drinking up to maybe, an extra glass of water to two glasses of water every day is really important. All right. So let's go to the next tip I have for you. And let's talk about myths. And I love these next sequence of slides because Lola is going to talk about some Dr. questions
Sodhi,
here.
Dr. Sodhi, we actually have a break right now to do a poll because we want to take in everything that you've just told us and really understand some of the nutrition and exercise. So let's ask the audience a question here. So I'm going to launch a poll. So here you should be able to see on your screen, which proteins are good for you. You can choose as many on that list as possible, but we want to know if you know which proteins are good for you based on what Dr. Sodhi has just shared with us. Well, it looks like baked chicken is the winner so far. 95% have selected that. Tofu, beans. There's a couple of people who said fried fish. What do you think about fried fish, Dr. Sodhi?
Yeah, fried fish is not good for you because it will absorb all the oils into it and the skin as well. So it'll increase your LDL. So that's usually not a go-to one.
Great. Well, it looks like the majority of people have taken this poll. And baked chicken, tofu, and beans are the top. So nobody said beef or pork or fried chicken. Let me share the results.
So you Excellent. Should be able to see that. Yes. Yeah. So one thing I didn't mention was tofu. Tofu is a really good source of protein, especially if you bake it. And that's one of my other substitutes. And if you're vegetarian, tofu is a great protein source as well as a good source of calories, as well as also reducing your cholesterol if you need a lot of protein and you need a good substitute. That is a really good substitute.
Well, we have a couple of moments for questions before we get to part two of your presentation. So if you have a question for Dr. Sodhi, please type your question in the Q&A box. We have a couple here so far. Char asks, what about gluten?
Yeah, so gluten is good if you're not on a gluten-free diet and you're not have any restrictions. Gluten is really good for just overall health and nutrients. It doesn't necessarily help with reduction of cholesterol, but it's good for overall just nutrients for overall health. But for those who have issues with gluten as well, who suffer from celiac disease, for example, there are some examples of gluten-free diets where you can avoid some of the vegetables that I mentioned, and you can actually still get the same source of the nutrients for that. And I didn't go over all of that, but that's probably like a whole nother talk.
And Leslie asks, is lean boneless pork chop bad?
It is, actually. So I'm sorry to say that. So you have to, the rounded meats are probably the best. The lean meats are probably the best, but the pork chops in general, no matter how you cook it, usually are the worst because they're very high in LDL and high in trans fats.
Good to know. Linda asks, you mentioned eating raw nuts, but I saw peanuts listed. Do legumes count as nuts? Can peanuts be eaten roasted?
So the roasted is the issue, because often when they do the roasted, they add salt. And that's the problem. If you look at the nutrients and the ingredients on the back end side, there's usually added salt, and that's what usually makes it really good. But you have to specify the ones that have unsalted. If it's unsalted roasted nuts, then it's often okay for you. But they have high in calories. And if you're on a calorie restriction diet, you have to be careful.
And then Vern and Claire ask, what about almond milk?
Yeah. So almond milk is a really good, for those who are, you know, have a vegan diet and they need a substitute. It's great, but just be careful. Some of the almond milks actually have some substitute saturated fats in it. So look at the nutrition label, make sure that it's not a high saturated fat in the backhand side. Almond milk usually has a really good source of protein as well as nutrients as well. It is a good substitute for you as long as there's not a lot of saturated fat in there. So look on the nutrition label on the carton.
And then we do have a couple more questions here, but I'm going to hold them until after we talk about medication, because some of the questions here are around medication. So I will go ahead and share where we're at with the PowerPoint presentation, and you can take over.
So let's go through myths. This is my favorite part of the talk. So we're going to have a series of questions, and they're all followed by true or false. So the first is, I know if I had high blood pressure because there would be warning signs. So true or false? And I think Lola, we're doing a poll, or we're just putting it in the chat.
You can type that right into the chat. And most people are saying false.
Excellent. And that is the correct answer. So we've known this for at least 40 years that high blood pressure can lead to cardiovascular disease, including strokes, heart attacks, and kidney disease. And unfortunately, often there is no warning signs. And so we often recommend at your primary care doctor's office or a routine provider, getting a resting blood pressure is one of the most important first steps to leading towards good cardiovascular health. And I encourage a lot of people out there, if they don't have a provider as of yet, just go down to the local CVS, purchase a blood pressure cuff. And, you know, if you go to CVS, sometimes they even have a blood pressure machine there. And just start to check your blood pressure at least once a day at rest, and maybe put it on your nightstand, write it down on a pen and paper, and track the trends. If you start to see a trend, and at least in the first day or two, your blood pressure is 140 or higher, you need to see a provider. It is a silent killer. And so I believe prevention is better than cure. And this is one of the most preventable cardiovascular risk factors. All right, myth number two. I'll know when I'm having a heart attack because I will have chest pain. Is that true or false?
We have a lot of falses coming in.
So I think a lot of people are saying false, and I'm going to say maybe. I tricked the people. So the reason why I say maybe is because yes, that's right. You don't necessarily have to have chest pain to have a heart attack. But if you're having chest pain, it doesn't mean that you don't have a heart attack. It still means you could be having a heart attack. So the point is that if you're having chest pain, often as providers, we do our necessary evaluation and testing to make sure you're not having a heart attack. And if your provider has done the due diligence of the testing and has determined that you don't have a heart attack, well, then the answer is false. So I would say if you're having chest pain, please see a provider. And the other thing to also know is that chest pain doesn't necessarily also mean that you're having a heart attack. You can be having shortness of breath You could be having fatigue and still having a heart attack. The problem is when patients often have risk factors such as diabetes, diabetes is a masquerader for a heart attack. And some diabetic patients may not even experience chest pain and still have a heart attack. And sometimes there are things called silent heart attacks where you're having small heart attacks and you have no idea what's going on. So that's why I think it's super important to follow up with your provider, even if you're having symptoms or no symptoms. So the next myth is diabetes won't threaten my heart as long as I take my medication. So the question is that true or false?
Our audience is saying false.
So as I said, this is a tricky one because it says won't threaten. So the answer I would say is false as well, because even though you're taking a medication for diabetes, diabetes is what we call a small vascular disease. So it can actually lead to microvascular disease and also lead to silent heart attacks. But there have been a lot of studies out there that have been shown with patients who have diabetes that is well controlled often do a lot better from a heart standpoint of view than patients that do not. So if you have diabetes, the most important thing is two things. One is ask your doctor, are you well controlled? And then number two is, am I on the right medication for diabetes that will reduce my risk of heart problems? As of 2015, there are actually newer medications out that are diabetes medicines that have actually helped diabetes and also helped reduce cardiovascular disease. And you need to ask your provider about these class of medications. So the point is that it won't threaten your heart, but as long as you're taking the medication, this statement is a false statement. But what you need to realize is that you can still have cardiovascular events, even if your diabetes is well controlled, but you need to make sure you're on the right class of diabetes medications, because there are some diabetes medications that reduce your risk of cardiovascular disease. So I like this one. This is often I have a variation of these statements when I see some patients. Heart disease runs in my family, so there's nothing I can do to prevent it. Sometimes I hear people say, well, I already have heart disease. It runs in my family, so why am I here? That's usually the two variations of the statement. So the question is this true or is this false?
Looks like our audience believe it's false.
And that is the correct answer. I was about to say that is true. I don't want to confuse people. But yes, that's the correct answer, because often the leading cause of heart disease running in within the family is not the genetics. The usual cause is preventable environmental risk factors. So what does that mean? And it stems with right diet, right choices, exercise, and also control of other cardiovascular risk factors. Believe it or not, if you do that, even if heart disease is predominantly in your family, even if it's a family history of premature coronary disease, that often leads to helping you preventing developing heart disease. I'm not saying hereditary is not important. Hereditary is important, but unfortunately at this time of age, we don't have really good therapies targeted towards genetic modifications to help prevent a heart disease. All we can do is control our cardiovascular risk factors, which starts with diet, exercise, and controlling high blood pressure, high cholesterol, and diabetes. This is my favorite one. Cardiovascular myth number 5. I should avoid exercise after having a heart attack. Is this true or is this false?
I think our audience is really smart.
So I think somebody said it right. The answer is it depends. And generically speaking, it's false. It depends. And it depends on when you're asking the question. So if you had a heart attack, God forbid, yesterday, usually what we recommend is not to be doing intense exercise within the first week. And that's often because we're adjusting medications that will help with remodeling of your heart, will help with longevity, will help with symptoms in the first week. And we want to make sure your vital signs are okay. And often when you have a heart attack, there is usually a slow recovery, and that's combined with physical fatigue. And sometimes you're just trying to recover from such a major heart attack. So often you're not motivated to pursue an exercise regimen. So I say it depends because you can't do intense exercise immediately right after a heart attack. But often what we tell people is enroll yourself into cardiac rehabilitation or cardiac rehab, because which is a stepwise exercise program over usually about 8 to 12 weeks, supervised environment, and with EKG supervised providers who often give you an exercise prescription in the first month. And if you don't have access to cardiac rehab, often I would say start slow, sure, but slowly. And that usually generically means you start with 10 to 15 minutes of walking, every few days of the week, and then you slowly increase the intensity and the duration of the exercise every week, watching your heart rate and watching your blood pressure. But if you before were an avid marathon runner, skier, and you had suddenly, God forbid, had a heart attack, and you're asking, can I go back to skiing right away? The answer is probably not right away, but eventually we build yourself up over several weeks to months to going back to skiing. So I say maybe on this one, but generically, overall, I say false as well. It just depends on what time you're asking this question. So we went from physical activity and nutrition as important lifestyle modifications in terms of preventing cardiovascular disease to, some of the myths of cardiovascular era. And now we're talking about just some cardiovascular risk, very common cardiovascular risk factors, which are very widespread around the world, which have been shown to lead to cardiovascular disease, including heart attacks, heart failure, strokes, and also death as well. So let's talk about each of these individual cardiovascular risk factors. Hypertension, which is definition of high blood pressure. As I mentioned to you before, the American College of Cardiology has defined high blood pressure as something as 140 consistently or above at rest. Pre-high blood pressure is anywhere between 130 to 139. Now that blood pressure goal will change if you have heart failure. But hypertension is treated with a lot of different approaches. The first approach is lifestyle changes with nutrition and exercise. And then second approach, as well as in combination, is with classes of medications. Often the classes of medications for high blood pressure, you have to worry about side effects are the following. One is your blood pressure can become too low if you're on too high of a dose of a blood pressure medication. That's often why we tell patients to please check your blood pressure at least once a day at rest, at least, and usually I say in the morning, because often you're taking your medications in the morning and you want to know what your blood pressure is before. The second side effect generically is we watch your labs, we watch your kidney function and your electrolytes. And that's why providers will often repeat labs to make sure you don't develop that side effect. In high hyperlipidemia, or in other words, high cholesterol, there are different flavors and different strategies to treat that. And again, just like with high blood pressure, the strategy includes changing your lifestyle, changing your physical activity in combination with classes of medicines. The most common is statins. You may hear examples of that: Crestor, Lipitor, Ruvastatin, Pivastatin. These are all statins. They do two things for you. They not only help reduce your LDL, which is the bad cholesterol, but they've been shown to help with longevity, even if your cholesterol is well controlled. So talk to your provider if the current choice of the statin is enough for you, and also is the current dose right for you. Generically speaking, these classes of medicines, we often have to check labs. Particularly, we have to check your liver function to make sure you don't develop that side effect. And then the other most common side effect that I see in about 5 to 15% of the time is muscle aches. So if you ever experience any of those two, or your lab abnormalities are present with high liver enzymes, you need to talk to your provider about that statin medication. The last cardiovascular risk factor, and we've touched upon this already, diabetes mellitus is usually a cardiovascular disease equivalent. As I said to you before, even if you're if you have the presence of diabetes, it doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to ultimately get cardiovascular disease. It's a matter of if you're well controlled. And the other important point is if you're actually on the right class of medications. As I said, after 2015, there's a class of medicines that have been shown to help with not only diabetes, but it also helps with cardiovascular disease. So talk to, and in summary, what I would say with these three cardiovascular risk factors, talk to your provider about these, making sure that you're well controlled on these three cardiovascular risk factors.
Thank you, Dr. Sodhi. We do have some questions from the audience, and we have a few minutes left. So please type your questions in the Q&A box. Dee asks, does sleep affect blood pressure? What if you are a poor sleeper?
So the answer is yes. There have been actually studies in patients who have sleep apnea, for example, which usually is a reason why patients don't sleep very well or get well-rested sleep, which leads to a lot of inflammation, a lot of catecholamine surge, and a lot of high cortisol levels when you get up. And it's a sort of like a vicious cycle. And then your blood pressure often is very high as a consequence. And as a result of that, indirectly, high blood pressure can lead to cardiovascular disease. So that actually has been shown for at least 20 years.
Leslie asks, if diet is working for cholesterol, should she still be taking a statin?
Great question. So it depends on your cholesterol panel. So if your diet is working and it's helping reduce your LDL to goal, and you don't have any other cardiovascular risk factors such as diabetes, then the answer is yes, you can stick with that. However, with that said, the American College of Cardiology changed its approach towards high cholesterol in 2013. So if your LDL, for example, is at goal, but you have the presence of diabetes and your diabetes is uncontrolled, then you need a statin.
So Chris asks, what do you think about drinking 2 cups of coffee a day?
So I love coffee. I'm a coffee fanatic as well. I don't like Starbucks.
You like your Keurig that we can't see behind you.
Yes, I have my Keurig there. That's right. But I don't like coffee with the syrup and you know that the Starbucks people put in there, because the syrup actually has a lot of sugar and a lot of LDL. So the answer is I do like my coffee. Now, people have this myth about coffee. Coffee leads to less longevity, more cardiovascular disease. So the answer generically is we don't know that answer. Okay. Now, with that said, this is what I will say. there are certain cardiovascular diseases out there. For example, a common electricity problem called atrial fibrillation. If you're one that has that diagnosis, you should ask your provider if coffee is safe for you, because sometimes coffee can trigger that bad electricity and it can lead to worsening cardiovascular disease. So you first have to ask yourself, if you do not have cardiovascular disease by definition, coffee in general, I think is safe and it's fine. But keep in mind that some people may actually develop palpitations, heart racing symptoms, headaches, and that is a signal or sign that you need to probably cut back and maybe talk to your provider and make sure that you're not developing any major medical issue.
Thank you. Victoria asks, what symptoms would result in a complete cardiac workup?
So if you have the presence of chest pain, or if you have the presence of shortness of breath, if you have the presence of palpitations, or even fatigue with exertion, that you say, well, gee, I used to be able to do that sort of form of activity maybe 6 to 8 months ago, but I'm starting to know notice my exercise tolerance or my functional capacity starting to diminish or get worse, you really need to have a full cardiovascular exam. And what does that entail? So first, it's a history, a full, thorough, detailed history. Second, physical exam. Third, a basic EKG. And then lastly, some lab work, including a cholesterol panel and also diabetes. The provider will take all of that into assessment and then review that with you with if anything needs to be taking a step further. And that could include seeing a cardiologist. And a cardiologist, if there's concern, may talk to you about an ultrasound of the heart, which we call an echocardiogram or a stress test.
Thank you. Chris asks, my husband has 3 heart stents and takes some pills. What do you say about potassium? With our vitamins, we also take a separate potassium supplement.
So it sounds like that potassium supplement may be prescribed, and usually it is. And if it's prescribed by a provider, that usually means that you're on a class of medicines called diuretics. Diuretics are important because they get rid of extra fluid that builds up because you may have some signs or symptoms of what we call congestive heart failure. So if your provider has prescribed potassium, it is important for the provider to repeat labs on a routine basis or maybe a serial basis to make sure your potassium levels don't rise too high. The values that we like to keep the potassium are between 4 and 5. But if you stop taking the diuretics, for example, and you're not peeing a lot where potassium is being dumped into the urine, then you may need to ask your provider if potassium needs to be stopped.
And Jane asks about potassium and wonders if it's hurting her kidneys.
So typically it's the other way around. When you have kidney failure, usually your potassium rises. It's not that potassium itself is destructive for the kidneys. It's usually the sequela. So if you have kidney issues, you need to be very careful with the dose of the potassium or taking potassium in general, because you don't want your potassium to rise too high. And if it's too high, it can lead to dangerous heart problems.
And then Chris wanted to just re-ask this question about potassium. So let's make sure that we get it correct. So re-asking about potassium, did Dr. Sodhi say it is all right? Or when to watch potassium levels or supplements? I think I heard you say that to have your doctor retest, right?
Right. So it's a simple blood work. It's called a basic metabolic panel. Make sure that if you have access to your labs by your computer or some sort of app to your health system, make sure the potassium is between 4 to 5. If it is above 5, the first thing I would do is stop the potassium. The other thing you also have to remember is that agents like losartan or some blood pressure medications, if you look at the ingredients, some of them actually have potassium in the medications. So you need to also talk to your provider about stopping that medication, because you don't want the potassium to rise even further if it's already greater than 5. Quite the opposite, if it's less than 4, then it's okay to continue the potassium.
Thank you for that clarification. Simi asks, is Indian tea bad for us? She says she's asking for her family, of course, being Indian. Our community heavily drinks the Indian tea, which I love tea as well.
Absolutely. So I think this piggybacks with the previous question about, is coffee bad for you? So the myth out there is that, you know, tea is better than coffee and coffee is bad for you. Well, the answer is we don't know the answer except one, and that is green tea. So green tea actually has a lot of good nutrients and it's really good for cardiovascular health. There have been some studies that have actually been shown for beneficial for better cardiovascular reduction disease. With green tea, but you have to be careful with what you put in the green tea. Me being Indian as well, often what we do is, and I've seen a lot of my aunties and uncles do this, they put a lot of whole milk in it with a lot of sugar. So you have to be really careful because it's not the tea then it makes it bad. It's the whole milk and the sugar because they'll have a lot of LDL and high cholesterol saturated fats. So if you put that a lot of in it, then it can be really bad. But if you substitute it with skim milk or you just substitute it with soy milk, often that is a better choice with Trivia, like for example, which is a natural sweetener rather than Splenda, for example.
We have time for one more question. I want to answer Dee's question. Dee asks, how does mental health affect heart health? Have you seen increases of heart disease during the pandemic related to isolation, anxiety, and depression? That's a big question, but I think it's super important.
That's a great question. So the answer is, first off, with full disclosure, we don't have the data as of yet in terms of the COVID era, in terms of mental health and the association with cardiovascular disease. However, with that said, what we know is we can extrapolate some what we've learned from other studies over the years. So the answer is yes, there is a strong association between mental health disease and cardiovascular disease. We don't quite understand why that is. We just know that there is a high association with that. We know that also on the same token, cardiovascular disease leads to often mental health disorders. There's a high rate of depression and also suicidal ideations and attempts with folks that have really high cardiovascular disease. And that's really under-recognized. And I see that unfortunately a lot. Patients that have had a recent heart attack where it affects their quality of life. If you were usually skiing and you're enjoying that, now you can't be doing that. You got to be very careful. Of course, that's going to lead to a really bad coping and bad mental health situation. And if you don't have really good coping strategies and don't have a good support system, that will compound itself and be a vicious cycle. So often I, as a cardiologist, I work very, very closely with a lot of my internal medicine colleagues who have the hat of prescribing and also treating from non-pharmacological approaches for psychiatric issues or diseases such as depression. And I work very closely with them and to say that, hey, listen, I need your help with this with this patient because she or he is suffering from major depression.
Thank you, Dr. Sodhi. We are out of time. And I want to remind our audience that our next webinar is next Tuesday with Jet Tila. He's a celebrity chef. You may have seen him on TV. In fact, he just released a new book. And he is going to show us some heart health recipes. And one of them will be hummus. I won't tell you what kind of hummus, but he put his own spin on it. So I'm really excited about that. And we will send you the recording and some supplemental information that Dr. Sodhi has shared. We've got some handouts for you that go over what he talked about today. So again, thank you for joining us and have a wonderful day.
Thank you.